This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The economic history of the United States is about characteristics of an important developments in the U.S. economy from colonial times to the present. The emphasis is on economic performance and how it was affected by new technologies, the change of size in economic sectors and the effects of legislation and government policy. Specialized teams and business history are covered in American Business History Contents 1 Colonial Economy to 1780s 11 Demographics 12 The Economy 121 New England 13 Urban Centers 14 Political Environment 141 Mercantilism 142 Free Enterprise 143 Taxation 15 The American Revolution 2 The New Nation 21 Industry and Commerce 211 Transportation 212 Automatic Flour Mill 213 Cotton Gin 214 Mechanized Textile Manufacturing 22 Finance, Money and Banking 3 The Early 19th Century 31 Agriculture, Commerce and Industry 311 Population Growth 312 Labor Shortage 313 Agriculture 314 Roads 315 Canals 316 Steam Power 317 Mechanical Power Transmission 318 Steamboats and Steamships 319 Railroads 3110 Finance, Money and Banking 3111 Manufacturing 31,111 Development of Interchangeable Parts 32 Political Developments 4 The Mid-19th Century 41 Commerce, Industry and Agriculture 411 Railroads 412 Iron Industry 413 Coal Displaces Wood 414 Manufacturing 415 Steam Power 416 Steamboats and Ships 417 Telegraph 418 Urbanization 419 Agriculture 4,191 Slave Labor 42 Finance, Money and Banking 421 Panic of 1857 43 Immigration Surge 44 Collapse of the South 45 Political Developments 451 Treasury 452 Land Grants 453 Education 454 Civil War 5 Late 19th Century 51 Commerce, Industry and Agriculture 511 Railroads 512 Steel 513 Electric Lights and Electric Street Railways 514 Communications 515 Modern Business Management 516 Agriculture 517 Oil, Minerals and Mining 5171 Oil 5172 Coal 5173 Iron Ore 518 Finance, Money and Banking 519 Water Supply and Sewers 5110 Labor Unions 6 Early 20th Century 61 Economic Growth and the 1910 Break 62 Industry, Commerce and Agriculture 621 Electrification 622 Manufacturing 623 Electric Street Railways 624 Electrochemicals 625 Railroads 626 Automobiles and Trucks 627 Highway System 628 Water Supply and Sewers 629 Agriculture 6210 Communications 62101 Telephone 62102 Radio 6211 Finance, Money and Banking 63 Political Developments 631 World War I 632 Roaring Twenties, 1920-1929 64 Quality of Life 7 from 1929 through World War II 71 Pre-War Industry, Commerce, and Agriculture 711 Manufacturing 72 Great Depression, 1929-1941 721 Spending 722 Banking Crisis 723 Unemployment 724 Relief 73 Wartime Output and Controls, 1940-1945 8 Post-War Prosperity, 1945-1973 81 Agriculture 82 Aircraft and Air Transportation Industries 83 Interstate Highway System 84 Mainframe Computers 85 Liberal Programs 86 Military and Space Spending 9 Late 20th Century 91 Post-Industrial Service Economy 92 Service Sector Expansion 93 Productivity Slowdown 94 Inflation Woes, 1970s 95 Deregulation and Reaganomics, 1976-1992 96 The Rise of Globalization, 1990s, Late 2000s 10 The 21st Century 101 Great Recession 11 Historical Statistics 111 1790-2006-G D P 12. See also 13 footnotes 14 bibliography 141 references 142 special studies 143 Data Colonial Economy to 1780s Shipping Scene in Salem, Massachusetts, a shipping hub. In the 1770s, the colonial economy differed significantly from that of most other regions in that land and natural resources were abundant in America, but labor was scarce. From 1700 to 1775, the output of the 13 colonies increased 12-fold, giving the colonies an economy about 30% the size of Britain's at the time of independence. Population growth was responsible for over three-quarters of the economic growth of the British American colonies. The free white population had the highest standard of living in the world. There was very little change in productivity and little in the way of introduction of new goods and services under the colonial system. Britain put restrictions on the type of products that could be made in the colonies and put restrictions on trade outside the British Empire. Demographics. Initial colonization of North America was extremely difficult, and the great majority of settlers before 1625 died in their first year. Settlers had to depend on what they could hunt and gather plus what they brought with them, and on uncertain shipments of food, tools and supplies until they could build shelters and forts, clear land and grow enough food and build gristmills, sawmills, iron works and blacksmith shops to be self-supporting. They also had to defend themselves against hostile Native Americans. After permanent settlements were established, population growth of the North American British colonies was very rapid due to high birth rates, 8 children per family versus 4 in Europe, and lower death rates than in Europe, and immigration. The long life expectancy of the colonists was due to the abundant supply of food and firewood and the low population density that limited spread of infectious diseases. The warmer climate of the colonies compared to Europe also contributed to longer life expectancy. However, the death rate from diseases was higher in the warm, humid southern colonies than in New England. The higher birth rate was due to better employment opportunities. Many young adults in Europe delayed marriage for financial reasons. Also, there were many servants in Europe who were not permitted to marry. The population of white settlers grew from an estimated 40,000 in 1650 to 235,000 in 1700. In 1690, there were an estimated 13,000 black slaves. The population grew at an annual rate of over 3% throughout the 18th century, doubling every 25 years or less. By 1775, the population had grown to 26 million, of which 21 million were white, 540,000 black and 50,000 Native American, giving the colonies about one-third of the population of Britain. The three most populated colonies in 1775 were Virginia, with a 21% share, and Pennsylvania and Massachusetts with 11% each. The economy. The colonial economy of what would become the United States was pre-industrial, primarily characterized by subsistence farming. Farm households also were engaged in handicraft production, mostly for home consumption, but with some goods sold. The market economy was based on extracting and processing natural resource and agricultural products for local consumption, such as mining, gristmills and sawmills, and the export of agricultural products. The most important agricultural exports were raw and processed feed grains, wheat, Indian corn, rice, bread and flour and tobacco. Tobacco was a major crop in the Chesapeake Bay region, and rice a major crop in South Carolina. Dried and salted fish was also a significant export. North Carolina was the leading producer of naval stores, which included turpentine used for lamps, rosin candles and soap, tar rope and wood preservative, and pitch ships' hulls. Another export was potash, which was derived from hardwood ashes and was used as a fertilizer and for making soap and glass. The colonies depended on Britain for many finished goods, partly because laws prohibited making many types of finished goods in the colonies. These laws achieved the intended purpose of creating a trade surplus for Britain. The colonial balance trade in goods was heavily in favor of Britain. However, American shippers were able to offset roughly half of the goods trade deficit with revenues earned by shipping between ports within the British Empire. The largest non-agricultural segment was ship building, which was from 5 to 20% of total employment. About 45% of American-made ships were sold to foreigners. Exports and related services accounted for about one-sixth of income in the decade before Revolution. Just before the Revolution, tobacco was about a quarter of the value of exports. Also at the time of the Revolution, the colonies produced about 15% of world iron. Although the value of exported iron was small compared to grains and tobacco, the mined American iron ores at that time were not large deposits and were not all of high quality. However, the huge forests provided adequate wood for making charcoal. Wood in Britain was becoming scarce and coke was beginning to be substituted for charcoal. However, coke made inferior iron. Britain encouraged colonial production of pig and bar iron, but banned construction of new colonial iron fabrication shops in 1750, but the ban was mostly ignored by the colonists. Settlement was sparse during the colonial period and transportation was severely limited by lack of improved roads. Towns were located on or near the coasts or navigable inland waterways even on improved roads, which were rare during the colonial period. Wagon transport was very expensive. Economical distance for transporting low-value agricultural commodities to navigable waterways varied but was limited to something on the order of less than 25 miles in the few small cities and among the larger plantations of South Carolina, and Virginia. Some necessities and virtually all luxuries were imported in return for tobacco, rice, and indigo exports. By the 18th century, regional patterns of development had become clear. The New England colonies relied on shipbuilding and sailing to generate wealth. Plantations, many using slave labor in Maryland, Virginia, and the Carolinas, grew tobacco, rice, and indigo, and the middle colonies of New York, Pennsylvania, New Jersey, and Delaware shipped general crops and furs except for slaves. Standards of living were generally high, higher, in fact, than in England itself. New England. The New England region's economy grew steadily over the entire colonial era, despite the lack of a staple crop that could be exported. All the provinces and many towns as well tried to foster economic growth by subsidizing projects that improved the infrastructure, such as roads, bridges, inns, and ferries. They gave bounties and subsidies or monopolies to sawmills, grist mills, iron mills, pulling mills which treated cloth, salt works, and glassworks. Most important, colonial legislatures set up a legal system that was conducive to business enterprise by resolving disputes, enforcing contracts, and protecting property rights. Hard work and entrepreneurship characterized the region, as the Puritans and Yankees endorsed the Protestant ethic, which enjoined men to work hard as part of their divine calling. The benefits of growth were widely distributed in New England, reaching from merchants to farmers to hired laborers. The rapidly growing population led to shortages of good farm land on which young families could establish themselves. One result was to delay marriage, and another was to move to new lands farther west in the towns and cities. There was strong entrepreneurship, and a steady increase in the specialization of labor. Wages for men went up steadily before 1775. New occupations were opening for women, including weaving, teaching, and tailoring. The region bordered New France, and in the numerous wars the British poured money in to purchase supplies, build roads, and pay colonial soldiers. The coastal ports began to specialize in fishing, international trade in shipbuilding, and after 1780 in whaling, combined with growing urban markets for farm products. These factors allowed the economy to flourish despite the lack of technological innovation. The Connecticut economy began with subsistence farming in the 17th century, and developed with greater diversity and an increased focus on production for distant markets, especially the British colonies in the Caribbean. The American Revolution cut off imports from Britain, and stimulated a manufacturing sector that made heavy use of the entrepreneurship and mechanical skills of the people. In the second half of the 18th century, difficulties arose from the shortage of good farmland, periodic money problems, and downward price pressures in the export market. In agriculture, there was a shift from grain to animal products. The colonial government from time to time attempted to promote various commodities such as hemp, potash, and lumber as export items to bolster its economy and improve its balance of trade with Great Britain. Urban centers. Historian Carl Bridenbaugh examined in depth five key cities: Boston, population 16,000 in 1760, Newport, Rhode Island, population 7,500, New York City, population 18,000, Philadelphia, population 23,000, and Charlestown. Charlestown, South Carolina, population 8,000. He argues they grew from small villages to take major leadership roles in promoting trade, land speculation, immigration, and prosperity, and in disseminating the ideas of the Enlightenment, and new methods in medicine and technology. Furthermore, they sponsored a consumer taste for English amenities, developed a distinctly American educational system, and began systems for care of people meeting welfare. The cities were not remarkable by European standards, but they did display certain distinctly American characteristics. According to Bridenbaugh, there was no aristocracy or established church, there was no long tradition of powerful guilds, the colonial governments were much less powerful and intrusive, and corresponding national governments in Europe, they experimented with new methods to raise revenue, build infrastructure, and to solve urban problems. They were more democratic than European cities, in that a large fraction of the men could vote, and class lines were more fluid contrasted to Europe. Printers, especially as newspaper editors, had a much larger role in shaping public opinion, and lawyers moved easily back and forth between politics and their profession. Bridenbaugh argues that by the mid-18th century, the middle-class businessmen, professionals, and skilled artisans dominated the cities. He characterizes them as sensible, shrewd, frugal, ostentatiously moral, generally honest, public-spirited, and upwardly mobile, and argues their economic strivings led to democratic yearnings for political power. Numerous historians have explored the roles of working-class men, including slaves, in the economy of the colonial cities, and in the early republic there were few cities in the entire South, and Charleston, Charlestown, and New Orleans were the most important. Before the Civil War, the colony of South Carolina was settled mainly by planters from the overpopulated Sugar Island colony of Barbados, who brought large numbers of African slaves from that island on the eve of the Revolution. 95% of the American population lived outside the cities, much to the frustration of the British, who were able to capture the cities with their Royal Navy, but lacked the manpower to occupy and subdue the countryside. In explaining the importance of the cities in shaping the American Revolution, Benjamin Karp compares the important role of waterfront workers, taverns, churches, kinship networks, and local politics. Historian Gary B. Nash emphasizes the role of the working class, and their distrust of their betters. In northern ports, he argues that working-class artisans and skilled craftsmen made up a radical element in Philadelphia that took control of the city starting about 1770 and promoted a radical democratic form of government during the Revolution. They held power for a while, and used their control of the local militia to disseminate their ideology to the working class and to stay in power until the businessmen staged a conservative counter-revolution political environment. Mercantilism. The colonial economies of the world operated under the economic philosophy of mercantilism, a policy by which countries attempted to run a trade surplus in order to accumulate gold reserves. The colonial powers of England, France, Spain, and the Dutch Republic tried to protect their investments in colonial ventures by limiting trade between each other's colonies. A mercantile policy that affected the British American colonies was the Navigation Acts, which were passed by the British Parliament between 1651 and 1673. Important features of the Navigation Acts are: foreign vessels were excluded from carrying trade between ports within the British Empire. Manufactured goods from Europe to the colonies had to pass through England. Enumerated items, which included furs, ship masts, rice, indigo, and tobacco, were only allowed to be exported to Great Britain. Although the Navigation Acts were enforced, they had a negligible effect on commerce and profitability of trade. On the eve of independence, Britain was entering the early stage of the Industrial Revolution, with cottage industries and workshops providing finished goods for export to the colonies. Free enterprise. The domestic economy of the British American colonies enjoyed a great deal of freedom, although some of their freedom was due to lack of enforcement of British regulations on commerce and industry. Adam Smith used the colonies as an example of the benefits of free enterprise. Colonists paid minimal taxes. Some colonies, such as Virginia, were founded principally as business ventures. England's success at colonizing what would become the United States was due in large part to its use of charter companies. Charter companies were groups of stockholders, usually merchants and wealthy landowners, who sought personal economic gain and, perhaps, wanted also to advance England's national goals. While the private sector financed the companies, the King also provided each project with a charter or grant, conferring economic rights as well as political and judicial authority. The colonies did not show profits, however, and the disappointed English investors often turned over their colonial charters to the settlers. The political implications, although not realized at the time, were enormous. The colonists were left to build their own governments and their own economy. Taxation. The colonial governments had few expenses and taxes were minimal. Although the colonies provided an export market for finished goods made in Britain or sourced by British merchants and shipped from Britain, the British incurred the expenses of providing protection against piracy by the British Navy and other military expenses. An early tax was the Molasses Act of 1733. In the 1760s, the London government raised small sums sums by new taxes on the colonies. This occasioned an enormous uproar, from which historians date the origins of the American Revolution. The issue was not the amount of the taxes, they were quite small, but rather the constitutional authority of Parliament versus the colonial assemblies to vote taxes. New taxes included the Sugar Act of 1764, the Stamp Act of 1765, and taxes on tea and other colonial imports. Historians have debated back and forth about the cost imposed by the Navigation Acts, which were less visible and rarely complained about the American Revolution. Americans in the 13 colonies demanded their rights as Englishmen, as they saw it, to select their own representatives to govern and tax them, which Britain refused the Americans. Attempted resistance through boycotts of British manufactured items, but the British responded with a rejection of American rights and the Intolerable Acts of 1774 in turn. The Americans launched the American Revolution, resulting in an all-out war against the British and to independence for the new United States of America. The British tried to crush the American economy with a blockade of all ports, but with 90% of the people in farming, and only 10% in cities, the American economy proved resilient and able to support a sustained war, which lasted from 1775 to 1783. Revolutionary-era cartoon showing U.S. sawing of the horn of a cow symbolizing a break from British commerce with a distressed Englishman watching as other European powers wait to collect milk. The cartoon represents the commercial status of the U.S. during the Revolution. The American Revolution 1775 to 1783 brought a dedication to unalienable rights to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, which emphasize individual liberty and economic entrepreneurship, and simultaneously a commitment to the political values of liberalism and republicanism, which emphasize natural rights, equality under the law for all citizens, civic virtue and duty, and promotion of the general welfare. Britain's war against the Americans, French and Spanish cost about £100. Congress and the American states had no end of difficulty financing the war. In 1775 there was at most $12 million in gold in the colonies, not nearly enough to cover existing transactions, let alone on a major war. The British made the situation much worse by imposing a tight blockade on every American port, which cut off almost all imports and exports. One partial solution was to rely on volunteer support from militiamen, and donations from patriotic citizens. Another was to delay actual payments, pay soldiers and suppliers in depreciated currency, and promise it would be made good after the war. Indeed, in 1783 the soldiers and officers were given land grants to cover the wages they had earned but had not been paid during the war. Not until 1781, when Robert Morris was named Superintendent of Finance of the United States, did the national government have a strong leader in financial matters. Morris used a French loan in 1782 to set up the Private Bank of North America to finance the war. Seeking greater efficiency, Morris reduced the civil list, saved money by using competitive bidding for contracts, tightened accounting procedures, and demanded the federal government's full share of money and supplies from the states. Congress used four main methods to cover the cost of the war, which cost about $66 million in specie gold and silver. Congress made two issues of paper money, in 1775-1780, and in 1780-81 the first issue amounted to 242. Rate of 1 cent on the dollar. By 1780, the paper money was not worth a continental, as people said, and a second issue of new currency was attempted. The second issue quickly became nearly worthless, but it was redeemed by the new federal government in 1791 at 100 cents on the dollar. At the same time, the states, especially Virginia and the Carolinas, issued over 200. Effort. These loans were repaid in full in the 1790s. Beginning in 1777, Congress repeatedly asked the states to provide money, but the states had no system of taxation either, and were little help. By 1780, Congress was making requisitions for specific supplies of corn, beef, pork and other necessities, an inefficient system that kept the army barely alive. The cities played a major role in fomenting the American Revolution, but they were hard hit during the war itself. 1775-83 they lost their main role as oceanic ports, because of the blockade by the British Navy. Furthermore, the British occupied the cities, especially New York 1776-83, and the others for briefer periods. During the occupations they were cut off from their hinterland trade and from overland communication. The British finally departed in 1783. They took out large numbers of wealthy merchants, who resumed their business activities elsewhere in the British Empire. The new nation chart 1, Trends in Economic Growth, 1700-1850. 50, the U.S. Constitution, adopted in 1787, established that the entire nation was a unified, or common market, with no internal tariffs or taxes on interstate commerce. The extent of federal power was much debated, with Alexander Hamilton taking a very broad view as the first Secretary of the Treasury during the presidential administration of George Washington Hamilton. Successfully argued for the concept of implied powers, whereby the federal government was authorized by the Constitution to create anything necessary to support its contents, even if it not specifically noted in it build lighthouses, etc. He succeeded in building strong national credit based on taking over the state debts and bundling them with the old national debt into new securities sold to the wealthy. They in turn now had an interest in keeping the new government solvent. Hamilton funded the debt with tariffs on imported goods and a highly controversial tax on whiskey. Hamilton believed the United States should pursue economic growth through diversified shipping, manufacturing, and banking. He sought and achieved congressional authority to create the first Bank of the United States in 1791. The charter lasted until 1811. After the war, the older cities finally restored their economic basis. Newer growing cities included Salem, Massachusetts, which opened a new trade with China, New London, Connecticut, and Baltimore, Maryland. The Washington administration, under the leadership of Secretary of the Treasury Alexander Hamilton, set up a national bank in 1791, and local banks began to flourish in all the cities. Merchant entrepreneurship flourished and was a powerful engine of prosperity in the cities. World peace lasted only a decade, for in 1793 a two-decade-long war between Britain and France and their allies broke out as the leading neutral trading partner the United States did business with both sides. France resented it, and the Quasi-War of 1798-99 disrupted trade. Outraged at British impositions on American merchant ships and sailors, the Jefferson and Madison administrations engaged in economic warfare with Britain 1807-1812, and then full-scale warfare 1812-1815. The result was additional serious damage to the mercantile interests, industry and commerce. Transportation: there were very few roads outside of cities and no canals in the new nation. In 1792, it was reported that the cost of transport of many crops to seaport was from one-fifth to one-half their cost. The cheapest form of transportation was by water, along the seacoast or on lakes and rivers. Automatic flour mill: in the mid-1780s, Oliver Evans invented a fully automatic mill that could process grain with practically no human labor or operator attention. This was a revolutionary development in two ways. One, it used bucket elevators and conveyor belts, which would eventually revolutionize materials handling, and two, it used governors, a forerunner of modern automation, for control. Cotton gin: the first cotton gin, conjectural image from 1869. Cotton was at first a small-scale crop in the South. Cotton farming boomed following the improvement of the cotton gin by Eli Whitney. It was 50 times faster at removing the seeds than with a roller. Soon, large cotton plantations, based on slave labor, expanded in the richest lands from the Carolinas westward to Texas. The raw cotton was shipped to textile mills in Britain, France and New England. Mechanized textile manufacturing: Samuel Slater 1768-1835. In the final decade of the 18th century, England was beginning to enter the rapid growth period of the Industrial Revolution, but the rest of the world was completely devoid of any type of large-scale mechanized industry. Britain prohibited the export of textile machinery and designs and did not allow mechanics with such skills to emigrate. Samuel Slater, who worked as mechanic at a cotton spinning operation in England, memorized the design of the machinery. He was able to disguise himself as a laborer and emigrated to the U.S., where he heard there was a demand for his knowledge. In 1789, Slater began working as a consultant to Ami. Located Oziel Wilkinson and his son David to produce iron castings and forgings for the machinery. According to David Wilkinson, all the turning of the iron for the cotton machinery built by Mr. Slater was done with hand chisels or tools in lathes turned by cranks with hand power. By 1791, Slater had some of the equipment operating. In 1793, Slater and Brown opened a factory in Pawtucket, Rhode Island, which was the first successful water-powered roller-spinning cotton factory in the USC. Slater Mill Historic Site: David Wilkinson went on to invent a metalworking lathe which won him a congressional prize. Finance, Money and Banking main article, History of Banking in the United States section. Steam power began being used in factories, but water was the dominant source of industrial power until after the Civil War. The building of roads and canals, the introduction of steamboats and the first railroads were the beginning of a transportation revolution that would accelerate throughout the century agriculture, commerce and industry population growth. Although there was relatively little immigration from Europe, the rapid expansion of settlements to the west, and the Louisiana Purchase of 1803, opened up vast frontier lands. The high birth rate, and the availability of cheap land caused the rapid expansion of population. The average age was under 20, with children everywhere. The population grew from 53 million people in 1800, living on 865,000 square miles of land, to 96 million in 1820 on 1,749,000 square miles by 1840. The population had reached 17,069,000 on the same land. New Orleans and St. Louis joined the United States and grew rapidly. Entirely new cities were begun at Pittsburgh, Marietta, Cincinnati, Louisville, Lexington, Nashville, and points west. The coming of the steamboat after 1810 made upstream traffic economical on major rivers, especially the Hudson, Ohio, Mississippi, Illinois, Missouri, Tennessee, and Cumberland rivers. Historian Richard Wade has emphasized the importance of the new cities in the westward expansion and settlement of the farmlands. They were the transportation centers, and nodes for migration and financing of the westward expansion. The newly opened regions had few roads, but a very good river system in which everything flowed downstream to New Orleans. With the coming of the steamboat after 1815, it became possible to move merchandise imported from the Northeast and from Europe upstream to new settlements. The opening of the Erie Canal made Buffalo the jumping-off point for the lake transportation system that made important cities out of Cleveland, Detroit, and especially Chicago. Labor shortage. The U.S. economy of the early 19th century was characterized by labor shortages. As noted by numerous contemporary observers, the labor shortage was attributed to the cheapness of land and the high returns on agriculture. All types of labor were in high demand, especially unskilled labor and experienced factory workers. Labor prices in the U.S. were typically from 30 to 50% higher than in Britain. Women factory workers were especially scarce. The elasticity of labor was low, in part because of lack of transportation and low population density. The relative labor scarcity and high price was an incentive for capital investment, particularly in machinery agriculture. Main article: History of Agriculture in the United States. The U.S. economy was primarily agricultural in the early 19th century. Westward expansion plus the building of canals and the introduction of steamboats opened up new areas for agriculture. Much land was cleared and put into growing cotton in the Mississippi Valley and in Alabama, and new grain-growing areas were brought into production in the Midwest. Eventually, this put severe downward pressure on prices, particularly of cotton, first from 1820-23 and again from 1840-43. The cotton trade, excluding financing, transport and marketing, was 6% or less of national income in the 1830s. Sugar cane was being grown in Louisiana, where it was refined into granular sugar. Growing and refining sugar required a large amount of capital. Some of the nation's wealthiest people owned sugar plantations, which often had their own sugar mills. Southern plantations, which grew cotton, sugar cane, and tobacco, used slave labor. Roads. There were only a few roads outside of cities at the beginning of the 19th century, but turnpikes were being built. A ton mile by wagon cost from between 30 and 70 cents in 1819. Robert Fulton's estimate for typical wagonage was 32 cents per ton mile. The cost of transporting wheat or corn to Philadelphia exceeded the value at 218 and 135 miles, respectively, to facilitate westward expansion. In 1801, Thomas Jefferson began work on the Natchez Trace, which was to connect Daniel Boone's Wilderness Road, which ended in Nashville, Tennessee, with the Mississippi River. Following the Louisiana Purchase, the need for additional roads to the west were recognized by Thomas Jefferson, who authorized the construction of the Cumberland Road in 1806. The Cumberland Road was to connect Cumberland, Maryland on the Potomac River with the Wheeling, West Virginia on the Ohio River, which was on the other side of the Allegheny Mountains. Mail roads were also built to New Orleans. The building of roads in the early years of the 19th century greatly lowered transportation cost and was a factor in the deflation of 1819-21, which was one of of the most severe in U.S. history. Some turnpikes were wooden plank roads, which typically cost about $1,500 to $1,800 per mile, but wore out quickly. Macadam roads in New York cost an average of $3,500 per mile, while high-quality roads cost between $5,000 and $10,000 per mile. Canal scene of Lockport on the Erie Canal. W.H. Bartlett, 1839. Because a horse can pull a barge weighing 50 tons compared to the typical 1 ton or less hauled by wagon, and the horse required a wagoner versus a couple of men for the barge, water transportation costs were a small fraction of wagonage costs. Canal shipping cost were between 2 and 3 cents per ton mile, compared to over 30 cents by wagon. The cost of constructing a typical canal was between $20,000 and $30,000. Only 100 miles of canals had been built in the U.S. by 1816, and only a few were longer than 2 miles. The early canals were typically financially successful, such as those carrying coal in eastern Pennsylvania. The 325-mile Erie Canal, which connected Albany, New York on the Hudson River with Buffalo, New York on Lake Erie, began operation in 1825. Wagon cost from Buffalo to New York City in 1817 was 192 cents per ton mile by Erie Canal C.A. 1857-60. The cost was 0.81 cents. The Erie Canal was a great commercial success and had a large regional economic impact. The Delaware and Raritan Canal was also very successful. Also important was the 25-mile canal bypassing the falls on the Ohio River at Louisville, which opened in 1830. The success of some of the early canals led to a canal building boom, during which work began on many canals which would prove to be financially unsuccessful. As the canal boom was underway in the late 1820s, a small number of horse railways were being built. These were quickly followed by the first steam railways in the 1830s. Steam power in 1780. The U.S. had three major steam engines, all of which were used for pumping water, two in mines and one for New York City's water supply. Most power in the United States was supplied by water wheels and water turbines during after 1840. By 1807, when the North River steamboat, unofficially called Claremont, first sailed, there were estimated to be fewer than a dozen steam engines operating in the U.S. Steam power did not overtake water power in the U.S. until sometime after 1850. Oliver Evans began developing a high-pressure steam engine that was more practical than the engine developed around the same time by Richard Trevithick in England. The high-pressure engine did away with the separate condenser and thus did not require cooling water. It also had a higher power-to-weight ratio, making it suitable for powering steamboats and locomotives. Evans produced a few custom steam engines from 1801 to 1806, when he opened the Mars Works foundry and factory near Philadelphia, where he produced additional engines. In 1812, he produced his successful Columbian engine at Mars. As his business grew and orders were being shipped inland, Evans and a partner formed the Pittsburgh Steam Engine Company in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Steam engines soon became common in public water supply, sawmills, and flour milling, especially in areas with little or no water power. Mechanical power transmission. In 1828, Paul Moody substituted leather belting for gearing in mills. Leather belting continued in use until it was displaced by unit drive electric motors in the early decades of the 20th century. Steamboats and steamships for steamboat monopoly, see Gibbons v. Ogden. Commercial steamboat operations began in 1807 within weeks of the launch of Robert Fulton's North River steamboat, often referred to as the Claremont. The first steamboats were powered by Boulton and Watt-type low-pressure engines, which were very large and heavy in relation to the smaller high-pressure engines. In 1807-08, Robert L. Stevens began operation of the Phoenix, which used a high-pressure engine in combination with a low-pressure condensing engine. The first steamboats powered only by high pressure were the Etna and Pennsylvania, designed and built by Oliver Evans in the winter of 1811-1812. The New Orleans became the first steamboat to travel down the Ohio and Mississippi rivers from Pittsburgh to New Orleans. The commercial feasibility of steamboats on the Mississippi and its tributaries was demonstrated by the Enterprise in 1814. By the time of Fulton's death in 1815, he operated 21 of the estimated 30 steamboats in the U.S. The number of steamboats steadily grew into the hundreds. There were more steamboats in the Mississippi Valley than anywhere else in the world. Early steamboats took 30 days to travel from New Orleans to Louisville, which was from half to one quarter the time by keel boat due to improvements in steamboat technology. By 1830, the time from New Orleans to Louisville was halved. In 1820, freight rates for keel boats were 5 cents versus 2 cents by steamboat, falling to 1/2 cent per pound by 1830. The SS Savannah crossed from Savannah to Liverpool in 1819 as the first transatlantic steamship. However, until the development of more efficient engines, trans-ocean ships had to carry more coal than freight. Early trans-ocean steamships were used for passengers, and soon some companies began offering regularly scheduled service railroads. Railroads were an English invention, and the first entrepreneurs imported British equipment in the 1830s. By the 1850s, the Americans had developed their own technology. The early lines in the 1830s and 1840s were locally funded, and connected nearby cities or connected farms to navigable waterways. They primarily handled freight rather than passengers. The first locomotives were imported from England. One such locomotive was the John Bull, which arrived in 1831 while awaiting assembly. Matthias W. Baldwin, who had designed and manufactured a highly successful stationary steam engine, was able to inspect the parts and obtain measurements. Baldwin was already working on an experimental locomotive based on designs shown at the Rainhill trials in England. Baldwin produced his first locomotive in 1832. He went on to found the Baldwin Locomotive Works, one of the largest steam locomotive manufacturers, in 1833 when there were few locomotives in the U.S. Three quarters were made in England. In 1838 there were 346 locomotives recorded in the U.S., three-fourths of which were made in the U.S. Ohio had more railroads built in the 1840s than any other state. Ohio's railroads put the canals out of business. A typical mile of railroad cost $30,000 compared to the $20,000 per mile of canal, but a railroad could carry 50 times as much traffic. Railroads appeared at the time of the canal boom, causing its abrupt end. Although some canals flourished for an additional half century, finance, money and banking. The charter for the first Bank of the United States expired in 1811. Its absence caused serious difficulties for the national government trying to finance the War of 1812. Over the refusal of New England bankers to help out, President James Madison reverses earlier Jeffersonian opposition to banking, and secured the opening of a new national bank. The Second Bank of the United States was chartered in 1816. Its leading executive was Philadelphia banker Nicholas Biddle. It collapsed in 1836, under heavy attack from President Andrew Jackson during his bank war. There were three economic downturns in the early 19th century. The first was the result of the Embargo Act of 1807, which shut off most international shipping and trade due to the Napoleonic Wars. The other two downturns were depressions accompanied by significant periods of deflation during the early 19th century. The first and most severe was during the Depression from 1818 to 21, when prices of agricultural commodities declined by almost 50%. A credit contraction caused by a financial crisis in England drained specie out of the U.S. The Bank of the United States also contracted its lending. The price of agricultural commodities fell by almost 50% from the high in 1815 to the low in 1821, and did not recover until the late 1830s, although to a significantly lower price level. Most damaging was the price of cotton, the U.S.'s main export food crop. Prices, which had been high because of the famine of 1816 that was caused by the year without a summer, fell after the return of normal harvests in 1818. Improved transportation, mainly from turnpikes, and to a minor extent the introduction of steamboats, significantly lowered transportation costs. The third economic downturn was the Depression of the late 1830s to 1843, following the Panic of 1837, when the money supply in the United States contracted by about 34%, with prices falling by 33%. The magnitude of this contraction is only matched by the Great Depression. Despite the deflation and depression, GDP rose 16% from 1839 to 43. Partly because of rapid population growth. In order to dampen speculation in land, Andrew Jackson signed the executive order known as the Specie Circular in 1836, requiring sale of government land to be paid in gold and silver. Branch mints at New Orleans, Dahlonega, Georgia and Charlotte, North Carolina were authorized by Congress in 1835 and became operational in 1838. Gold was being withdrawn from the U.S. by England, and silver had also been taken out of the country because it had been undervalued relative to gold by the Coinage Act of 1834. Canal projects began to fail. The result was the Financial Panic of 1837. In 1838 there was a brief recovery. The business cycle upturn occurred in 1843. Despite the deflation and depression, GDP rose 16% from 1839 to 43. However, population growth during the period was rapid. Economic historians have explored the high degree of financial and economic instability in the Jacksonian era. For the most part, they follow the conclusions of Peter Temin, who absolved Jackson's policies. countries, and blamed international events beyond American control, such as conditions in Mexico, China, and Britain. A survey of economic historians in 1995 showed that the vast majority concur with Temin's conclusion that the inflation and financial crisis of the 1830s had their origin in events largely beyond President Jackson's control and would have taken place whether or not he had acted as he did vis-a-vis the Second Bank of the U.S. Manufacturing starting with textiles in the 1790s, factories were built to supply a regional and national market. The power came from waterfalls, and most of the factories were built alongside the rivers in rural New England and upstate New York. Boston Manufacturing Co., Waltham, Massachusetts. Before 1800, most cloth was made in home workshops, and housewives sewed it into clothing for family use or trade with neighbors. In 1810, the Secretary of the Treasury estimated that 2/3 of rural household clothing, including hosiery and linen, was produced by households by the 1820s. Housewives bought the cloth at local stores and continued their sewing chores. The American textile industry was established during the long period of wars from 1793 to 1815, when cheap cloth imports from Britain were unavailable. Samuel Slater secretly brought in the plans for complex textile machinery from Britain and built new factories in Rhode Island using the stolen designs. By the time the embargo Act of 1807 cut off trade with Britain, there were 15 cotton spinning mills in operation. These were all small operations, typically employing fewer than 50 people, and most used Arkwright water frames powered by small streams. They were all located in southeastern New England. In 1809, the number of mills had grown to 62, with 25 under construction to meet increased demand for cloth. Several manufacturers resorted to the putting out system of having the handloom weaving done in homes. The putting out system was inefficient because of the difficulty of distributing the yarn and collecting the cloth, embezzlement of supplies, lack of supervision, and poor quality. To overcome these problems, the textile manufacturers began to consolidate work in central workshops, shops where they could supervise operations, taking this to the next level. In 1815, Francis Cabot Lowell of the Boston Manufacturing Company built the first integrated spinning and weaving factory in the world at Waltham, Massachusetts, using plans for a power loom that he smuggled out of England. This was the largest factory in the U.S., with a workforce of about 300. It was a very efficient, highly profitable mill that, with the aid of the Tariff of 1816, competed effectively with British textiles at a time when many smaller operations were being forced out of business. The U.S. began exporting textiles in the 1830s. The Americans specialized in coarse fabrics, while the British exported finer cloth that reached a somewhat different market. Cloth production, mostly cotton but also wool, linen, and silk, became the leading American industry. The building of textile machinery became a major driving force in the development of advanced mechanical devices. The shoe industry began transitioning from production by craftsmen to the factory system, with division of labor. Low return freight rates from Europe offered little protection from imports to domestic industries. Development of interchangeable parts. Main article, interchangeable parts. Standardization and interchangeability have been cited as major contributors to the exceptional growth of the U.S. economy. The idea of standardization of armaments was originated by French General Jean-Baptiste Viquet de Gribeauval, who in 1765 began instituting the Gribeauval system. Honoré Blanc, who